Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Softly Calls the Serengeti, written by Frank Coates and read by Jerome Pride. The dedication reads, "To the people of Kibera, whose courage, determination, and compassion for their fellow citizens were the inspiration for this book, and to the many legitimate and dedicated charities who bring hope to them." Prologue. Nairobi, October 2002. It is hot and still for an October day. A boy hurries through the alleys of Kibera. There is a storm in the air. He stops, checks the sky. Red smoke hangs above the rusted iron rooftops. Far away, there is a rumble of thunder. A black kite shrieks a warning call, and there is an answer from beyond the walls of rusty iron and rough-sawn timber that fashion his neighbourhood. Urgent voices come from somewhere beyond the twists and turns of the narrow alleys. The boy squeezes into a gap as a group of young men dash past, muttering in breathy gasps. The shriek comes again, but now it is not that of a black kite. Perhaps it never was. An old woman, the gossip of the neighbourhood, comes scuttling towards the boy. He catches her eye. She sees him, but says nothing as she hurries by. The scream again. Not of fear this time, but of horror. The boy starts to run. He knows these putrid, narrow paths. He has played in them since he could walk. Still, he misjudges his leap across the stinking open sewer in the alley, and slimy mud and shit splash his bare legs. He crashes into a rusty wall on the other side, and a protruding nail tears into his forearm. He stifles a whimper and runs on. A cloud of acrid smoke swirls through a cross alley. It makes his eyes smart as he plunges through it. Another scream. A scream to halt his heart. A scream for help. No longer can he hold to the idea of the kite. It is an inhuman sound, but he knows it's a woman's voice. He slams shut the vision that comes to mind, but the scream occurs again, and the door is flung open. He knows whose voice makes those heartbreaking sounds. He knows whose throat gave flight to them. He runs faster down the stinking path, another cross alley, flames licking through the smoke. He stands in the mud. The screams are gone, but his ears are ringing with their memory. The grimy alleys are silent. Thunder rolls across the blackened sky. Flames rise and colour his stricken face. He stares with eyes of ice at the burning remains of his home. Chapter 1. November 2007. Joshua Otieng was narrow of hip and chest, but he had an athlete's bearing and the swagger of a young Takataka man who had made his first sale on the streets when he was about 7 years old. Back then, those sales had earned him a pittance, but it had been an important contribution to a family struggling to avoid hunger, especially when his father failed to find work as a casual labourer. Now, 10 years on, Joshua seldom failed to clinch a deal once his unerring radar had detected a mark among the stream of cars crawling towards the Kenyatta Avenue roundabout. He would engage his quarry with his compelling dark eyes and winning smile before the persuasion began in earnest. The haggling and the deal were complete, and the mark's money in his bag before the traffic lights changed. The boy had the lanky build of his Luo father and the sharp commercial mind of his Kikuyu mother. He could get by in Kiswahili, Somali, and English, as well as the Kikuyu and Doluo of his parents. Among his many gifts was the ability to guess the mother tongue of his prospective client and use it to charm open the purse or wallet of all but the most obstinate. He had learnt his languages and also his street savvy in the alleys of Kibera, the squatter settlement situated a mere 20 minutes' walk from Nairobi's central business district. In the mornings he sold newspapers, and later in the day it would be anything at all, usually cheap junk, takataka, imported from China. That afternoon he was selling little paper butterflies, whose gaudy wings were set frantically flapping by means of an elastic band. A dozen butterflies were cocooned in a thin plastic shopping bag hanging from his waist. Quasi was working the lane nearest the road divider. With his twisted spine and stiff leg, he couldn't escape to safety fast enough when the traffic column suddenly lurched into motion. Joshua didn't mind Quasi hogging the right-hand lane. In spite of the age difference of some 4 years, he had been a friend for as long as Joshua had worked the Kenyatta Avenue roundabout. It was Quasi who had loaned his younger friend the stock to make a start, and after the car accident that had crippled Quasi a year later, at age 12, Joshua had shared his takings with his friend until Quasi was back on the street again. A car had dragged Quasi 200 metres down Uhuru Highway, breaking bones, tearing muscle and ligaments, and leaving his face distorted into a grotesque leer. Now, Quasi sold a more basic commodity. Guilt. People were prepared to pay to assuage the relief they felt that neither they nor their loved ones were disfigured like the poor crippled boy begging at the Kenyatta Avenue roundabout. Quasi's real name was Gabriel. Just like the angel, his deceased parents used to say proudly to friends. But after the accident, it didn't seem to fit. The nickname came from a Frenchman who had been one of Quasi's regular customers for the morning papers.
"What happened to you, Gabriel, huh?"
he asked in his thick accent when Quasi finally returned to his usual place.
"I didn't recognize you."
Quasi mumbled a brief reply about the car accident.
"Merde,"
the French Mzungu muttered.
"Quasimodo, non?"
The name appealed to Quasi. Shortened, it had an African ring to it. So it stuck.
"Hey, Quasi,"
Joshua called now from his line.
"You want to finish?"
Quasi pulled a handful of coins and small notes from his pocket.
"Ndio," he said. "Let's go."
Quasi kept his battered wheelchair hidden among the shrubbery in nearby Uhuru Park. Joshua had found the chair years before in the mountain of rubbish he and his mother used to quarry in search of items she could sell to Kibera residents from her little stall on the main entry to the settlement. He and Quasi had restored it using cannibalized bicycle parts, although they'd never quite mastered the wheels, one of which had an alarming wobble. But the pain-free mobility that the machine offered Quasi made his life a little more bearable. Joshua pulled the wheelchair from its camouflage and slipped his unsold butterflies into the carry bag hanging from the handles. He retrieved his mobile phone from his pocket and deftly thumbed through his text messages, reading some and quickly responding to others, as Quasi rolled along the pavement beside him. When they reached the incline on Haile Selassie Avenue, Joshua gave Quasi a helping hand until their route again eased downward towards Kibera. The Kibera squatters' settlement was the largest slum outside South Africa's Soweto, but technically the place didn't exist. There were no title deeds to the land. Kibera was therefore a vast collection of illegal dwellings. The situation suited the authorities. As it was an illegal settlement, they had no responsibility to provide essential services such as water, schools, sanitation, garbage collection, roads, and health services. Private dealers provided water standpipes, charging twice the water utility rate in legal housing developments. Landlords felt no obligation to maintain houses in Kibera, many of which were built in dangerous or unhealthy locations amid sewers and garbage dumps. Typhoid, worm infestations and skin diseases were prevalent among the settlement's residents. The police were rarely seen in Kibera, and never after dark. Vigilante groups brought thieves to justice for a price.
"Have you got football training, Josh?" Quasi asked.
"Maybe."
As usual, Joshua felt vaguely guilty about leaving his friend behind in order to attend his practice session.
"Michael texted me to say he can't make it, and he usually brings the ball."
"You should go. Someone will bring a ball. And you need to practice every day. Next year, you'll see. The national selections. Practice hard, my friend." Ah, that is for dreaming, Quasi. Who will come to Kibera to find a football player? The selectors will be out at Niayo Stadium or Moy International. Then you will go to Niayo. Joshua made no reply. They'd had the same conversation many times. He didn't dare buy into Kwazi's fantasy about a stadium brimming with ecstatic screaming fans as Joshua dashed downfield, the goal mouth beckoning. The reality of Kibera football was a generally shoeless contest, with a worn soccer ball, no referee, and with teams differentiated between shirts and skins. The games often ended in an intertribal brawl, or were broken up by the administration police as an illegal gathering. Joshua's team was lucky to have a training pitch, the one remaining open field in Kibera, which it shared with dozens of other groups. Local chiefs and greedy businessmen had progressively sold all the other sporting fields in Kibera for housing plots and dukkah shacks. Realistically, Joshua held little hope of being considered to try out for, let alone be selected to play in, a real soccer team. He was the best striker in Kibera's informal league, but he knew this would count for nothing among the elitist national selectors. At the laneway leading to Kwazi's hut, Joshua bade his friend goodbye. When Kwazi was out of sight, Joshua began to jog down Kibera Drive towards the football ground. By the time he reached the clearing, he was running at full pace, and while his teammates laughed and joked and kicked a ball to each other in a circle, Joshua continued to run laps, the sweat streaming from his body. Once he joined the field of play, Joshua kicked and passed, cut and intercepted, covering all points on the pitch. At one moment he was defending. At another he was in the forefront of the attack, using his famous curving strike to drive home a goal. His dedication no longer elicited the ribald comments it once had. His teammates had accepted it was just Josh being Josh, driven by his strange compulsion to be fitter, stronger, and faster than anyone else who came along to kick the tattered football around the dusty field. 2 hours later, and 30 minutes after the last of his teammates had deserted the field, Joshua headed for home, tired, but full of the energy the game imparted to him. As he crossed the road towards Kibera, he heard someone call his name. It was Gideon Koska.
"Hey, Otieng," he said. "Do you not know your friends these days?"
Koska was a businessman from the Kalenjin tribe, and Joshua's occasional benefactor, offering him odd jobs, usually of dubious legality.
"Habari, Mr. Koska,"
Joshua said, a little abashed. He returned to the curb where Koska sat at a small roadside stall or dukkah, sipping tea. The dukkah proprietor eyed Joshua, then went on with his work of washing cups.
"Jumbo,"
Joshua said as he reached Koska's table.
"Sorry, my friend. Come, sit."
Joshua sat on the offered wooden crate.
"I was thinking about something and I didn't see you," he said.
Koska ignored the comment and took a sip of his tea. Everyone in Kibera knew Gideon Koska, either personally or by reputation. He was a big man with large protruding eyes and a callous opportunist who had initially made his money by claiming ownership of any disputed land in Kibera. Since titles were a rarity in the illegal settlement, he was able to intimidate or harass other claimants until they retreated from the ownership contest. This enabled him to sell the sites to the many desperate people clamoring for space upon which to erect a simple shelter. He then extracted further payments from the new owners to keep the new dwelling safe. His thugs were despised and feared throughout the settlement. Joshua had heard Koska had used the wealth he accumulated from his illegal land dealings to buy influence in the ruling political party. There were rumours that he was backing the opposition in the upcoming elections. Joshua disliked Koska, but opportunities to earn extra cash overrode the whim of personal preference. Koska noisily slurped his tea while Joshua waited patiently.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.